it's a reasonable compromise. We'll start now, and this is, consider this an official opening. I'm using my privilege of being the coordinator of computer science to welcome, and but I won't speak too much. So my distinct honor and pleasure to announce the first speaker of today is Professor Mel Fitting, who had the pleasure of being Raymond's close friend and student. And let's listen what Mel has to share.
Thank you very much. I'm going to do something that I've only done once before in my life, and that is I've actually written a speech which I'm going to read. So there are also a few videos as part of it. My initial plan for this talk was to discuss some simple examples of how Raymond's mathematics had been influential. I had two items in mind: uniform notation, which has become common in automated theorem proving and some branches of proof theory, and elementary formal systems, which unwittingly at the time provided the semantics for prologue. I had even begun preparing slides, but I realized this was not appropriate. The best discussion of Raymond's work is by Raymond himself. What is wanted here is a general discussion of the man and his remarkably many facets, and that is what I have decided to try for. I knew Raymond longer than he knew me. I recently did some calculations and realized, much to my surprise, that I knew Raymond a bit short of three quarters of my life. But I am just 75. He was 97 when he died and had known me only a little more than half of his long life. I didn't meet him until he was in his mid-40s. Fortunately, Raymond wrote about his early life, and others have written biographies, and I have drawn on them as well as on my personal memories. Raymond Merrill Smullyan was born May 25th, 1919, in Far Rockaway, a part of New York City very far from the city's centers. He said more than once how happy he was there. It's a curious fact that he was a classmate of Richard Feynman in grade school, though I never heard any inclination on Raymond's part to physics. He did have an early interest in chemistry, however. His father was a businessman from Belgium. The family was musical. His father played the violin and his mother the piano. Early on, Raymond played both violin and piano, eventually concentrating on piano. In 1929, the Great Depression hit, and Raymond's family had to move from Far Rockaway to the city, where he attended high school. This move saddened him deeply, and he mentioned it many times over the years. Raymond came from a generally talented family. His brother Emil was an economist, and his cousin Robbie became a painter and art dealer, specializing in commercial art, if I recall correctly. Raymond also had a sister, but I never met her and have almost no information. The extended family was very close, getting together frequently. Arthur and Robert Smullyan were cousins. Actually, they were double cousins. Fathers were brothers and mothers were sisters. Arthur became a philosopher, best known for analyzing the problems with Quine's understanding of the scope distinction in Bertrand Russell's work on definite descriptions. And an aside here, when I teach certain kinds of philosophical logic courses and I say, well, Smullyan said, you have to explain at that point that it isn't Raymond. Arthur first introduced Raymond to mathematical logic. Many years later, Raymond's brother Emil and his wife Etta bought a house in the Catskills, and Raymond found this so attractive that he and his wife Blanche built a house next door, where both of them would live out the rest of their lives. Raymond was always someone who did things his own way. In high school, he was undecided between a career in mathematics and one in music. He moved between high schools, looking for one that was good in both areas, and eventually dropped out and studied on his own. I believe he got a GED instead of a conventional high school diploma, and actually he may not have even gotten that, I'm not entirely sure. At that time, he taught himself calculus, group theory, Galois theory, and this is a place for a personal anecdote. He developed his own approach to Galois theory, perhaps at this time, perhaps later. I don't mean new theorems, but new ways of presentation and organization. Many years later, when I was in graduate school, I took his course in modern algebra using his presentation of Galois theory. This would have been around 1965. I took quite detailed notes, which I still have. Perhaps 2 years ago, he called me and asked about those notes. He wanted to turn them into a book. I sent them to him, but his health was beginning to deteriorate, and he felt his mind beginning to slow. He never wrote the book, but among the last things we spoke about was whether I would be willing to try writing it up. I told him I would try, but the outcome is uncertain. He owned the subject in a way that I do not. However this eventually comes out, it's a good example of Raymond's ability to focus on whatever interested him over long periods to the exclusion of whatever was felt to be unimportant in his life. College was something like high school in that Raymond came and went between several. While attending one, he met Bernard Abramovich, who was a well-known pianist and teacher. Perhaps Abramovich's best-known pupil was the composer David Del Tredici. Raymond studied piano with Bernard and lived in his house in California for a time. This was the start of a long friendship. Many years later, I met Bernard at Raymond's house in the Catskills. I remember a short, friendly man with interests that certainly went beyond music. In the small world way of things, Irene Schreier Scott recently wrote me, "You know, I have known Ray for most of my life in so many different situations, since I was 9 years old when he was studying piano with Bernard Abramovich in San Francisco. Much, much later, he introduced me to Dana. Earlier in Chicago, he often came to my parents' home, always with a whole train of the most interesting friends from the University of California. The Dana mentioned is the mathematician and logician Dana Scott." An aside, Raymond, despite his very public persona, was an intensely private person. He was very often on and would happily tell jokes and anecdotes, but getting to a real conversation took time and the right environment. Such conversations, when they happened, could be insightful and thought-provoking, but personal details were often suppressed. For instance, I believe that somewhere around the time of college, he was married briefly. I never heard details, and I'm not entirely sure if this is true. This was typical. Things he did not want to talk about never got talked about. I remember a number of years ago, Peter Abramovich, Bernard's son, wanted to video an interview with Raymond as part of a projected documentary about it. He asked if I would take part as a kind of interviewer. We set things up. I tried asking Raymond questions about events and feelings in the past, but they were all deflected with polite but uninformative answers. Eventually, we simply gave up. The documentary was never made. Raymond essentially dropped out of college, living with his parents in New York without a job. It was during this time that he learned to perform magic, created chess puzzles, and continued studying modern algebra. Typical life of a dropout. He also continued with his musical career. A biography he wrote mentions his playing piano in the Beethoven First Piano Concerto, which is interesting because while his musical tastes were wider than one might have supposed, he eventually narrowed his own playing largely to Schubert, Scarlatti, Bach, and perhaps a few others. There are quite a few recordings of him playing these, many on YouTube, but I don't believe there's much else, at least I haven't seen much else. I mentioned chess puzzles as one of Raymond's interests during his dropout period. If you're not familiar with Raymond's puzzles, they involve retrograde analysis. Instead of asking what happens next, they ask what happens before. Typically, a piece is missing and one wants to deduce information about it. This kind of puzzle was suggested to Raymond by his double cousin Arthur. Such problems are not really chess problems, but problems in logical deduction. Many years later, Raymond built his puzzles into stories, and these were published as The Chess Mysteries of Sherlock Holmes in 1979 and The Chess Mysteries of the Arabian Nights in 1982. My first wife, Greer Fitting, did the illustrations for the Arabian Nights book, as she also did for his 1982 Alice in Puzzle Land. I will not attempt to reproduce one of his chess puzzles here. Suffice it to say, he considered his best puzzle to be Mystery of the Missing Piece, which he created when he was 16. It is in the Holmes book, and presentation of the reasoning going into the solution takes 4 pages. Raymond attended several colleges, finally received an undergraduate degree, which brings up a story Raymond was fond of telling, and I'm sure many of you here have heard the story. Without yet having a college degree, he received an offer from Dartmouth to be an instructor in mathematics, having been recommended by Carnap. He taught there for 2 years, and they wanted to keep him longer, The problem was Raymond didn't have a college degree or even a high school diploma. That's when the University of Chicago decided to give him credit for courses he hadn't taken and had been teaching at Dartmouth. And that's how he finally managed to get his undergraduate degree from Chicago. Even so, he didn't remain teaching at Dartmouth, but became a graduate student at Princeton. He received a PhD with Alonzo Church as his mentor. This was in 1959, when he was already 40, a late start for an academic career. But his academic work actually begins earlier. Raymond's first published paper preceded his degree and remains one of his most cited academic works, Languages in Which Self-Reference is Possible, appearing in the Journal of Symbolic Logic in 1957. In it, he reduced Gödel's machinery for proving incompleteness to a minimum, establishing that such results held for formal systems substantially weaker than piano arithmetic. In a sense, he extracted the essential core of Gödel's argument, presenting it in all the elegant style for which he was to become known. His 1959 dissertation gave rise to several published papers, and the dissertation itself was published in 1961 by Princeton University Press as Raymond's first book, Theory of Formal Systems. It introduced a remarkable range of influential material. In it, his earlier work from Languages in Which Self-Reference is Possible was developed as part of an extensive general approach. A new automata theoretic class called rudimentary was introduced. Fundamental results in recursion theory were proved, in particular a double recursion theorem. And what was of most interest to me personally, an extremely simple formalization of recursion theory itself was created, elementary formal systems. This reduced the machinery needed to define recursive enumerability and the recursive functions to an intuitively attractive minimum. In the late 1960s, there was much work concerning the notion of computation, in particular, what might computation mean over arbitrary structures, not just over numbers or things that can be coded by numbers, but just in general, computing directly with the objects you're interested in. Many different approaches were introduced and equivalences were established. I remember the time very well. Much depended, for instance, on whether the structure admitted a recursive pairing function. But in two short abstracts in 1956 in the Bulletin of the American Mathematical Society, Raymond had already sketched elementary formal systems for arbitrary structures and noted that on a structure of arithmetic, it yielded ordinary recursion theory. On a structure of words over a finite alphabet, it yielded Turing computability on words, and so on. But as he had a general solution. Unfortunately, this generality was not actually discussed in his book, Theory of Formal Systems, and the extent of applicability was not generally known until years later. Finally, it was realized that what he had done was equivalent to what many others had been doing much later. For a number of years, logic programming was an important topic of research in computer science. A semantics was developed for it, without negation as failure, if you know what that is, by Van Emden and Kowalski in 1976. It wasn't realized until later that Raymond's elementary formal systems on the structure of formal terms essentially coincided with Prolog, and the Van Emden-Kowalski approach had already appeared in one of Raymond's 1956 abstracts. It should give some idea of the fruitfulness of Raymond's work that important developments could lay there unrecognized because there was so much else to think about. Raymond continued teaching as a lecturer at Princeton until 1961, at which point he moved to the Belfer Graduate School of Yeshiva University, where he remained until 1968. At this point, my life began intersecting his. I went to an engineering college, Rensselaer Polytechnic Institute, graduating with a degree in mathematics in 1963. In college, one of the courses I took was based on Raymond's theory of formal systems, which had just come out. I liked it very much. At the suggestion of the professor who taught that course, I applied to Belfer Graduate School, where both Raymond and Martin Davis were. I was accepted and started there in the fall of 1963. I no longer remember dates and details, but I do remember that I took the same logic course with both Raymond and Martin. Probably one was official, one was not. It was enlightening to see just how different two approaches to the same material could be. Raymond made use of a preliminary version of what became his first-order logic book. Martin finished his course with a thorough presentation of work on Diophantine equations. Hilbert's tenth problem had not yet been solved. It was an exciting time. I should mention today Davis plays an essential role in what became the solution to Hilbert's 10th problem, but that was a few years after I graduated from Yeshiva. I chose to work with Raymond. He was then, as he always was, an elegant and insightful teacher. Presentations were an art form. At that time, co-enforcing, that's in set theory, was new. Saul Kripke's modal semantics was new. I wound up combining the two. I remember telling Raymond that my dissertation was running long. He told me to write it as a book, which was excellent advice. It did become my first book. Raymond's second book, that's after Theory of Formal Systems, was First Order Logic in 1968. The idea, in part, was to simplify Beth's semantic tableau machinery and use it as the basis for theorem proving in classical first-order logic. Along the way, the model existence theorem was introduced with a different name, uniform notation was presented, a constructive proof of cut elimination was given in an abstract setting that yielded it simultaneously for both tableaus and sequent calculus. Those of you who know what this means know what this means. Those of you who don't. This is not a complete list of innovations from that book. The book has influenced several generations of logicians and has been reprinted in the Dover Book Series in 2010. This work has also had an unanticipated life in computer science in the field of automated theorem proving. The annual Tableau Conference has been meeting since 1992 and is devoted to the use of Tableau methods applied to a wide range of logics. Most of the papers at these meetings trace back to Raymond's book in one way or another. A side note, I remember when First Order Logic was first printed and Raymond was sent a copy. While the contents were fine, the cover announced First Order Logic, L-O-G-I-K, logique, with a Germanic K. The printing had to be called back and redone. Probably there are no copies of this curiosity left now, but it's a nice thing to see. I received my PhD in 1968, and by this time Raymond was not just a mentor, but a friend. I came to know his wife Blanche, a dear and remarkable woman. Originally from Belgium, she was a cultured, independent person who had founded a music school in Manhattan, though by the time I came to know her, the school was no longer being run. I mentioned a note from Irene Schreier Scott. Did you know I had actually introduced him to Blanche? I had no idea what would ensue, but I am so happy it happened. It was a long and happy marriage, and Blanche was a good friend. Blanche passed away in 2006 at the age of 100, having been cared for at home by Raymond and assistants during the last years of her life. In the 1960s, Raymond and Blanche lived in the brownstone that had once housed Blanche's music school. Blanche was an excellent pianist, though she didn't seem to enjoy playing in public the way Raymond did. I visited there often and stayed there from time to time when I had my farm upstate. The brownstone had rooms full of grand pianos, a Mozart piano, a clavichord, a remarkable place. Downstairs, a small blackboard had been set up, and at one point, Raymond explained Gensen's proof of cut elimination to me in terms of tableaus. I think his summary was, keep pushing cuts further down the tree while reducing formula complexity. Eventually, all cuts will be at branch ends, and these easily disappear. That simple summary, in fact, is quite enough to reconstruct the full proof, but let's skip over technicalities. By 1968, Belfer Graduate School was having problems, and faculty were leaving. City University's Hunter College was splitting. The so-called Uptown branch became a separate institution, Herbert Lieben College. Raymond and I were both hired there. It was a different time from today. The chair, Is Rose, who later became not just a colleague but a friend, interviewed the two of us together, casually. I don't remember meeting a committee or there being many formal complexities. I remained at CUNY and at Lehman at the CUNY Graduate Center for the next 44 years. Raymond stayed until 1982 when he became Oscar Ewing, Professor of Philosophy at the University of Indiana, Bloomington, where he was until his retirement in 1989. I should mention that he hated the idea of retirement. He loved teaching, but at that time there was still a mandatory retirement age and nothing could be done about it. This is no longer the case, but the change in the law came too late for Raymond. Nonetheless, retirement did not mean retirement in any concrete way where Raymond was concerned. Backing up a bit and returning to the late 1960s, Raymond and Blanche decided to build a house in the Catskills next door to Raymond's brother, Emil, and his wife, Etta. I remember the house when it was just a pile of lumber. Unfortunately, things did not go well. The contractor was less than honest. The house stood higher than intended because the basement was not excavated to the proper depth. Windows leaked. The grand piano could not go upstairs because a support beam had been omitted from the downstairs ceiling. But over time, other contractors corrected these things. One major step involved wrapping a cable around the house and pulling it tightly together, then constructing permanent ties inside to hold things after the cable was removed. Eventually, it became a pleasant, livable house in a very beautiful part of the country. I once wrote a children's story, George and the Sandcastle. It's on my website. It's actually based on events of that house, though perhaps nobody but me would recognize this. Visiting Tannersville, where the Smullyan house was always an adventure. It was a constant assortment of mathematicians, musicians, or whatnot. It was there I came to know Stanley Tenenbaum, for instance. Sometimes in the morning, one would hear Raymond upstairs playing Schubert. There were books on every subject, local theater groups to visit. It was an isolated outpost that brought the big world to its living room. In 1971, I was married for the first time to Greer Woodruff. With my parents and my wife's sister attending, the marriage took place in the Smullyan living room. After a year or so, my wife and I bought an abandoned farm further upstate than Tannersville. Unlike the Smullyans, we were serious about farming, but that didn't rule out visits. There were many. We had two children, both of whom have fond memories of visiting Raymond and Blanche. At some point, Raymond, having been attracted by a dog in a pet store window, came home with it, peekaboo. Raymond was uncomfortable with having the dog neutered, so there were a couple of litters of pups before he changed his mind reluctantly. The Smullyans kept, I think, five dogs altogether, and homes were found for the rest. We wound up with one, Benedict, a loyal and faithful friend through good times and bad. My father-in-law, Oscar Collier, was a literary agent. He asked me if I would consider writing a book, something like Mathematics for the Millions, which had sold well for years. I was not interested, but I knew Raymond had started developing logic puzzles with a popular appeal. Somehow I got the two of them together, and my father-in-law became Raymond's agent for many years. Eventually, our farm was sold. We were divorced in 1983, and I faced the job of raising two daughters. After some tumult, which we will skip over here, I wound up in Westchester, where I still live. My parents provided continuity for my daughters, of course, but so did Raymond and Blanche. This was a job for old friends, and these old friends did their job well. I mentioned our dog Benedict. He had gone from the Catskills to our farm, to my parents' house, to Westchester. Throughout, he remained faithful, friendly, and a comfort to be around. Eventually, he developed a sore on its leg, and it would not heal. The vet recommended removing the leg, and after much thought, I agreed. In fact, the dog lived happily for many more years. But the procedure was very expensive relative to my financial state at the time. I happened to mention this to Raymond once, and a few days later a check arrived covering the operation. Raymond was a kind and generous man in his quiet way. Time passed. It does so more quickly, it seems, as life goes on. I was married a second time in 1992 to Roma Simon, and we are happy together while aging less gracefully than we would like. My children became adults, both now have children of their own. They visited Smullyans from time to time, then Blanche died in 2006 at the age of 100. Visits continued, but distances made this difficult. Still, it was a remaining connection with their childhood. I am sorry my grandchildren will never know Raymond. They were very young when he was very old, and now it is impossible. The rush of mathematical creativity that Raymond experienced in the late 1950s gradually evolved to a more encompassing point of view. Raymond wrote several books giving his mature thoughts about the topics that had always occupied him since his dissertation, Theory of Formal Systems. These books are Gödel's Incompleteness Theorems, 1992, Recursion Theory for Metamathematics, 1994, and Diagonalization and Self-Reference, also 94. While I was at the Belt for graduate school, Raymond lectured on set theory. He had worked out very nice treatments of ordinals, the axiom of choice and its relatives, constructible sets, class set theory. He did not really grasp the new method of forcing. My dissertation had been on forcing. One day in the 1990s, we were visiting Tannersville, Raymond suggested the two of us write a book on set theory, and we did. The first two parts were based on Raymond's class notes. The third part on forcing was a redevelopment on my part of my thesis work, bringing modal logic into it in a way that I thought was more natural than my original approach. The resulting book, Set Theory and the Continuum Problem, appeared in 1996 and is now in a second edition with Dover. Surprisingly, this is our only joint work. In fact, Raymond has almost no joint work. There's a joint paper with Anil Narode in 1962, one with Hillary Putnam in 1960, and I believe that's it. As I mentioned before, at some point in the 1970s, while continuing as mathematical logic researchers, Raymond developed an interest in puzzles that are based on logic. Martin Gardner devoted a column in the magazine Scientific American to some of these, and they turned out to be quite popular. This led to What is the Name of This Book in 1978. It was quite successful. It was followed by other books. This Book Needs No Title, 1980, Alice in Puzzle Land, 82, and many, many more. There have been a large number of translations into many languages, and non-academics probably know Raymond entirely through these works. Raymond realized that puzzles could be used to get across some of the fundamental discoveries of modern logic. This led to his book, The Lady or the Tiger, in 1983, which took readers through the basic ideas of Gödel's incompleteness theorem via a series of puzzles. This was followed by To Mock a Mockingbird, 1985, which explored the lambda calculus via puzzles about birds. The lambda calculus is a system of formal logic with applications to the design and semantics of computer languages. Raymond's book was of such interest that the automated theorem proving group at Argonne National Labs once developed a program specifically for solving his so-called bird puzzles. In fact, it used to be a setting, a switch you could set in their theorem prover called bird print, printing solutions for these things. Another work along these lines is Forever Undecided, 1987, which discusses Gödel's theorem in greater detail than before, also modal logic and provability logics. Raymond's book, Satan, Cantor, and Infinity, 1992, discusses issues of probability, infinity, time, and issues largely through his familiar medium of puzzles. And I should mention The Magic Garden of George B. and Other Logic Puzzles, 2007, which uses puzzles to represent Boolean algebra and the stone representation theorem. He's turned the stone representation theorem into a puzzle. It's amazing. In his last works, Raymond turned back to a more conventional format and wrote two textbooks, which he hoped would be useful in the teaching of first-order logic and its meta-theory. These are A Beginner's Guide to Mathematical Logic, 2014, and A Beginner's Further Guide to Mathematical Logic, his last book, published last year. Raymond's bibliography is available on the website for this conference. I did some counting. Raymond published 8 mathematical books, 22 popular books, including the puzzle books. There was also one book he co-edited about pianists at the Piano Society. Not bad for a dropout. Raymond had numerous interests outside logic. He was intense, concentrating on these sometimes to the exclusion of all else, but his personal interests were in fact of interest to many. As we heard earlier, Raymond was a first-rate pianist and once considered a career as such. Essentially, a bout of tendonitis put an end to this as a career. Several of his performances can be found on YouTube, and one CD is available for purchase. And what I want, there are a couple of videos I want to do here, and one is a video that I made of him in 2000. He wanted to see how things would record. So let me just, this is just one short excerpt from the,
And now for an encore, I will play one of my favorite tunes, the Moment Musical. I have memory.
What?
I have memory lapse.
Okay.
It's possible.
If you're interested, the full video is somewhere longer than half an hour and is available through the website for this conference. In his younger days, Raymond supported himself as a professional magician, doing sleight of hand at tables in a nightclub. Almost to the end of his life, when he visited a restaurant, he would bring a pack of cards and would go from table to table. I've seen this happen often, and always a good time was had by all. And this, this is what his mathematical talks tended to look like at this point in his life. This is a small piece of a talk he gave in Romania.
What a widow is this? I put this handkerchief in my pocket. At the count of three, it will leave my pocket, fly around the room, and come back into my pocket again.
Good.
One, two, three. I felt it leave my... Can you see it?
Yeah. Yeah.
And now it's back in my pocket again. What's that a good thing? People don't realize what I've done. Look. Any magician could make a handkerchief leave his pocket and fly around the room. That's trivial. You learned that the first day of magic school. But to make the handkerchief become invisible during its flight, that takes doing. You people are skeptical. I really did. I'll show you once more. You take the handkerchief, you see? And what I'll do is this. Take it, see? One, two, three, flies around the room, and you can't see it. And showing up, it's back on my pocket again. You see, I wasn't kidding you. I'll tell you something very interesting. Actually,
they don't believe it. They don't believe it.
Actually, this handkerchief is a magic handkerchief. I can make it change to any desired color. Any color I just saw. Any desired color.
Yeah.
What?
Yellow.
White?
Yeah.
When I say any desired color, I mean any color I desire. Actually, white is not a bad suggestion. I will make a change to a shade of white you've never seen before, one which is logically impossible that you'll ever see again. I'm going to make a change to what is technically known, after actually lower it, as an invisible white. You can see it facing on this side, but that side is totally invisible. But the heat of the hand makes it become visible again. See? I'll show you once more. You take the handkerchief, and all you do is this. You see, you throw it around the room, it flies around the room in a completely invisible condition, and it goes back to my pocket. Is that a good trick? Excellent. I'll tell you how this works. But I don't want you to tell anybody. I told you it was based on an Einsteinian relativistic principle. The whole thing was a swindle. That handkerchief never disappeared. That handkerchief remained where it was. What I did was, I made the rest of the universe disappear away from it. Any expression of the form H, X, where H is a predicate, and X is any expression whatsoever. That's what I mean by ascendance. Now, each predicate is the name of a set of expressions. And the expression HX expresses a proposition. X belongs to the set named by H. And more precisely, I define HX to be true if and only if X really does belong to the set named by H. That is a precise definition of a true sentence. Now, two symbols, R and N,
play a particularly important role. The word in is to suggest the word not. The word or is to suggest the word repeat. By the repeat of an expression x, I mean x followed by itself. Now, I'm given the system obeys the following two rules.
So, first of all, you understand this is all part of the same talk. Somehow he makes the transition from that first part to the second part. And the other is that second part actually harkens back to his languages in which self-reference is possible, at the very beginning of his career. There were other lesser interests that would have been major for anyone else. He had a lifelong enthusiasm for astronomy, and when I knew him, he was making his own quite large telescopes, grinding his own lenses. Much later, he became interested in sound reproduction and put together some very formidable speaker systems with somewhere around 40 speakers, each of which could be individually controlled, to experiment with sound balance and related aspects of music reproduction. Raymond also experimented with three-dimensional photography for many years. He developed a way to build viewers that were better and cheaper than those commercially available, and even published an article about it. At some point, Raymond became interested in making videos. This required the use of a computer, and so he purchased one, an Apple Mac. I regularly got calls asking how to do something or other. These ranged from where is the semicolon key to how to use iMovie to edit video. He became quite good at it. The culmination was a video he made in 2006, Remembering Blanche, a tribute to his wife who had recently died. It was a remarkable thing. He combined still photos with videos others had taken over many years and ended with a moving series of pictures of Blanche taken the day before she died. It was a direct look at the cumulative effects of time, seen in the face of someone he loved and who no longer related to the world around her. Although Raymond claimed to not know if he was religious, he had a deep interest in Eastern religions. Probably his best known writing in this area is The Tao is Silent from 1977. And I have one last video to show you here. This is Raymond reading from a well-known poetry collection called Cold Mountain.
I have lived here thinking long. But yesterday I called on family and friends. Over half no longer with us. Bit by bit, life fades like a sputtering lamp, passed on like a river that never ends. Today I face my lonely shadow, my eyes blurred with tears. As I said, I stated earlier, I wrote the poem Imitation Cold Mountain. I might others have told, this inspired me to try my own at writing verses in the spirit of Cold Mountain. Here are some I came up with. The doubt is like a wandering cloud, not knowing its destination, but getting there nevertheless. You make master plans, let the Tao take over, and you'll get there without trying. Enter the Buddha mind, and you will live again, only this time with no tangled mind. The Buddha nature embraces all and is available to everyone. From here to there, in these mountains, lie precious treasures of old. Only rocks? Yes. But why bother with silver and gold, when you can enjoy the light of the moon. Drifting along without purpose, the eternal life. Serving the purpose without having one is to be in accord with the Tao. That's what I wrote.
That's very nice.
That's all in the spirit.
I last visited Raymond sometime in January. He had become very frail. A full-time assistant was necessary. Raymond could not even move from one chair to another by himself. Still, twice a day, he and his attendant would go out to eat. Perhaps the human contact was necessary to him. His conversation remained lively. It was about the political situation, philosophy, all the old things, except for much about mathematics. He felt his mind was no longer quick enough to follow mathematical arguments. In general, he was still interested and interesting, but he was waiting for it to be over. On my previous visit, he had turned to me at one point and asked, "Doesn't it make you sad to see me this way?" He smiled as he said it, but it did make me sad, and I said so. His waiting is now over. Raymond passed away February 6, 2017, at the age of 97. To quote Irene Schreier Scott one more time, somehow Raymond was supposed to go on living forever, just in some magical way be transformed into pure spirit. Thank you.
So as announced, we'll just proceed with the program. Coffee break, and please. And our next speaker is distinguished professor Graham Priest. The title is on the screen. please.
Thanks, okay. Well, it's a great privilege to be here commemorating Ray. I didn't know him very well, unlike Mel. I met him once or twice, I think. I was once at a conference in Copenhagen. He was giving a lecture. About halfway through the lecture, he said, "Oh, this is getting boring." So he pulled out a deck of cards and spent the rest of the time doing card tricks. I mean, he was obviously a remarkable character. Sort of in his later years, I reckon he was sort of a dead ringer for Gandalf. But his wizardry was of a completely different kind. And as Mel said, he had many different interests. And I want to talk about just one of them, which Mel mentioned very briefly, and it's Taoism. Let me get rid of the cursor. Okay. So, this may seem to be unconnected with Ray's other interests, but bear with me, it's not. So, there's a very famous book called the Tao Te Ching. Sometimes you see it spelled Tao Te Ching, okay? It's just a question of the convention you use for transliterating into from Chinese characters into English. So this is Wade Giles, which is the sort of modern standard. Sorry, no, this is Pinyin, which is the modern standard. This is Wade Giles, which is older. It's one of the two fundamental texts of Taoism. Traditionally, it was thought to have been written by someone called Lao Tzu, who was a rough contemporary of Confucius. But modern scholarship suggests it's a much, much later text, probably several hundred years later, not by a single person at all, but it's a compilation of sayings by old masters. Well, Lao Tzu can also mean old masters. Okay, and if you read it, it does look like a collection of sayings. However, it's one of the most influential books in the history of Chinese philosophy, without doubt. And what I'm going to say concerns that. Now, the connection with Ray is that he published this book, The Tao is Silent. It came out with HarperCollins in 1977. So, Mel is giving you enough about Ray's history that you can place this in sort of chronological developments of his interest. And what this book is Ray's commentary on Taoism. It's a light-hearted book. I mean, it's not sort of meant to be serious, but I think it says a lot of things about Ray. So let me just read you the beginning of one of the chapters. Okay, this is a chapter called Crazy Philosophy and Sensible Philosophy. Okay, I'm not going to try to imitate his accent. Okay. I'd roughly divide philosophers into two categories, crazy and sensible. Of the two, I definitely prefer the former. Sensible philosophers are noted for their sobriety, propriety, rationality, analytic skills, and other things. One definite advantage they have is they're usually quite sensible. Crazy philosophers are characterized by their madness, spontaneity, sense of humor, total freedom from most basic conventions of thought, amorality, beauty, divinity, naturalist, poesy, absolute honesty, freedom from inhibitions, contrariness and paradoxicalness, lack of discipline, and general yumminess. Okay, their most important advantage over the sensible philosophers is they come far closer to the truth. Many philosophers of the sensible school will surely dispute this and ask me whether I can prove this statement. My answer is yes, quite easily, provided I'm allowed to give a crazy proof rather than a sensible one. But of course, they won't allow this. It's very interesting how different people fall into two categories. In general, I'd say that psychologists, psychiatrists, economists, sociologists, and political scientists tend towards the sensible. Whereas artists, poets, musicians, and, to my great delight, chemists, theoretical physicists, mathematicians, especially mathematical logicians, tend towards the crazy end. I have found from experience that the most brilliant logicians I've ever met have both a deep understanding of the sensible and also a wonderful feeling for the crazy. And no wonder. Crazy philosophy is the most refreshing thing in the world. It's thoroughly enlightening and is an absolute prerequisite to understand things as they really are. That gives you a sort of sense of the tenor of the book. And it's obviously in a very puckish mood. Although, you know, the book is interesting, even though it's written in this very light-hearted spirit. Okay, so that's the background to the book. I want to talk about one of the chapters, which talks about one of the chapters of the Tao Te Ching. Okay, so that's Ray started to look like Gandalf. Okay, now let's talk about the Tao Te Ching, verse one. If this is one of the most famous verses of literature, poetry, philosophy, call it what you like, in Chinese history, okay? Ray was certainly, Mel just read a poem about, from Ray, about his sort of Taoist attitudes. So he certainly had Taoist inclinations, all right? So he certainly took this stuff very seriously. When I came across Taoist writings, I was infinitely delighted. I didn't feel I was reading something strange or exotic, but that I was reading the very thoughts that I'd had all my life, only expressed better than I'd ever been able to express them. So he's serious in this very light-hearted book. Okay, so here's the first verse of the Tao Te Ching. It's translated many different ways. For those of you who can read the original, it's there. Okay, so this is one kind of standard translation. The Tao that can be described in language is not the constant Tao. Tao means way. The name that can be given is not the constant name. Nameless, it's the origin of the myriad things. Named, it's the mother of the myriad things. It's not clear what it means, but it looks kind of paradoxical. Hey, you know, you can't talk about something, but I'm talking about it. Now, there's a discussion of what this passage means in Ray's chapter. And this is, he says, well, I don't really know what to make of this, but I reckon it means something like this. The Tao is so remarkably sensitive that when named, it changes ever so slightly. It's not quite the same Tao as it was before it was named. In line with this interpretation, it might be more appropriate to refer to the Tao as unnameable rather than nameless. It's unnameable because it changes in the very process of naming it. Okay. Now, I don't actually think this is a very good interpretation of that verse. And I'm going to give you two reasons, one of which is much more serious than the other. But here's the less serious. This character, where are we? This character is a name, okay? Chinese, pardon my pronunciation, is Ming. Name does not mean what name means in English, okay? Name refers to one of these characters. And these characters express all sorts of things. They're closer to sort of predicates than proper names. So when the text says you can't name the Tao, what it's really saying is you can't predicate anything of the Tao, right? Now, if you think about Ray's suggestion about how to understand this, what he's sort of saying is that whenever you predicate something of the Tao, then it ceases to have that property because it changes. Because, I mean, it's not, we often predicate things and they change, right? But still, the predication remains the same. So if I call my motorbike a motorbike and paint motorbike on the side, and so name it, it's still the same motorbike, and it's still a motorbike. So it's very, very hard to see how the mere predication of something could ipso facto make that predication cease to be true. Okay, but the Tao is a strange thing, so who knows. But, I mean, for that reason, that philosophical reason, I don't find this a very plausible interpretation of the text. So let me then give you, I think, a much more sensible reason why this is not a good interpretation of the text. In China, there is a long commentorial tradition of Taoist texts, this is not... I mean, there are other interpretations of this particular chapter of the Tao which look much more reliable, okay? So in Asian philosophy in general, you often have to look to the commentarial tradition to kind of figure out what's going on in the text. So I looked up a commentary by Wang Bi. So Wang Bi there is dates. He died when he was very young. He died when he was about 30, I think. And he wrote a number of really interesting texts, and one of them was a commentary on the Tao Te Ching. So I'm going to tell you what Wang Bi's interpretation of that passage is. Okay. So this is the text, and this is Wang Bi's commentary. So this is the first half of chapter one, right? The Tao that can be described in language is not the constant Tao. The name that can be given it is not the constant name. Wang Bi's commentary. The Tao that can be rendered in language and the name that can be given it point to a thing or reproduce a form, neither of which is in its constancy. This is why it can neither be rendered in language nor given a name. Can't be rendered in language. You can't talk about it. Okay, chapter one continues. Nameless, it's the origin of the myriad things. Named, it's the mother of the myriad things. So Wang Bi's commentary, anything that exists originates in nothingness, which is a sort of synonym for the Tao. Thus, before it has forms, and when it's still nameless, it serves as the origin of the myriad things. And once it has formed and is named, it grows them, rears them, ensures their proper shapes, and matures them as their mother. In other words, Tao, by being itself formless and nameless, originates and brings the myriad things to completion. They're originated and completed in this way, yet do not know how it happens. This is the mystery beyond mystery. Okay, so the picture might be kind of not very clear, but something's clear about it. You've got the flux of phenomenal events, right? And behind that, there's this kind of principle, Tao, way, which somehow generates all these things and brings the myriad things into being. Okay, so that's a very standard interpretation of chapter one. Now, you might want to say, well, yeah, that's fine. It's clear that you can't, Wang Bi thinks you can't name the Tao. You can't predicate anything of it. It's beyond that. That's what he says in the commentary on the first half. Then you might want to say to yourself, well, you know, why suppose that? Well, Wang Bi is a philosopher, so he gives arguments. Let me give you two of his arguments. So This is the first argument that Wang Bi gives in his commentary. The way things come into existence and efficacy comes about is that things arrive from the formless. It's another synonym for the Tao. And that efficacy emanates from the nameless. The formless and the nameless is the progenitor of the myriad things. Okay, well, we've just had that. It's neither warm nor cold, nor makes neither the note gong nor the note shang. If it were warm, it couldn't be cold. If it were the note gong, it couldn't be the note shang. If it had form, it would necessarily possess the means of being distinguished from other things. If it's made of sound, it would necessarily belong to among the other sounds. So here's the thought. The thought is, look, it can't be any particular thing, because if it was such a thing, it couldn't produce other things, right? So it has to have an indeterminacy, otherwise it couldn't generate anything. Those of you who know the Timaeus will know that Plato has a very similar argument about the cola. It has to be beyond description just because it can take any possible form. There's a very similar kind of argument. That's the first argument. Second argument. Even the most replete, as long as it can still be expressed in words, would never have the capacity to govern heaven and earth. And the greatest thing that can possibly have form would never be large enough to house those myriad things. Any name for it would fail to match what it is. Any comparison for it would fail to express all that it is. A name necessarily involves how one thing is distinct from other things. And a comparison necessarily involves how the tenor of one thing depends on the vehicle of another. Making distinctions, any name would fail to be inclusive. Being dependent, any comparison would fall short of all that it is. As it cannot be perfectly inclusive, any name for it would deviate greatly from the truth. As it cannot express all that it is, any comparison for it would fail to designate what it really is. So here's an argument that the Tao is so great that it transcends any human categories. Whatever you say, it's got to be more powerful beyond that. And if you know a little bit about the history of Christianity, you will know that many medieval Christian theologians use exactly the same argument about God. Okay, you can't really describe God, maybe at best in metaphors, because God is greater than any human concepts. Well, this is Wang Bi's version of the argument. All right, so look, first of all, Wang Bi tells us that what this passage means is that you cannot talk about the Tao, and then he gives you some arguments as to why you can't talk about the Tao. Now, you don't have to think for very long about this, all right? If you're giving arguments why you can't talk about the Tao, you've got to talk about the Tao. Right. So there's a paradox here. Okay, the paradox of the ineffable. The Tao is ineffable. You just got that. And the reason is as follows, fill in the dots, which describes the Tao. So you're describing the ineffable. You're talking about something that can't be talked about. That's the paradox of the ineffable. This kind of paradox is so bloody obvious, you don't have to think about it for very long, okay? You don't have to be Immanuel Kant to see there's a paradox here, okay? And Wang Bi is a very smart philosopher, okay? It would have been clear as anything to him that he's courting contradiction here. What does he say about it? Well, he doesn't comment on it. He seems to be quite happy to let the matter rest there. So, from Wang Bi's text, it seems to be quite clear that he's quite happy with this contradiction. There's something you can't talk about, but of course you can, because you can explain why you can't talk about it. All right, so look, you might say at this point, hey Graham, you know, you're taking a very light-hearted book by Raymond Smullyan, and you're turning this into sort of some kind of textual thing, you know. It's not a scholarly book, it's Ray talking about his philosophy of life. That's not fair. Well, there's a method in my madness, okay? Because I want to focus on this thing, the paradox of the ineffable. And what I've just shown you is that it would certainly seem that 1B endorses this paradox. There's something which is ineffable, which you can talk about. Now, you might want to say, this is all crazy Eastern philosophy, right? Don't find this stuff in the West. You know, no sane Western philosopher would do this kind of stuff. Wrong, okay? There's a whole, many Western philosophers have discussed the limits of thought, the limits of language, and they have argued about why there are things beyond these limits. Okay? This puts them in exactly that situation. Hey, let me tell you that there are some things you can't talk about. Let me tell you why. Oops, and I've talked about them. Okay? So, which great philosophers are in this league? Well, yeah. There's one. Kant. Noumena are things beyond space and time. Things in space and time are phenomena. Noumena are things beyond space and time. Okay, so when you talk about something, you have to apply categories to it, like all, some, real, cause. And Kant points out that these can only be applied to things in space and time. So he says quite explicitly, you can't actually talk about noumena. Pardon me? The first critique is full of this stuff, right? Kant's in there. Wittgenstein's in there. This is the Wittgenstein of the Tractatus. Wittgenstein writes a whole book about the relationship between language and reality. And it turns out that a proposition describes a state of affairs if it's kind of isomorphic to it, has the same form. He doesn't use that word, but that's what he means. So a lot of the Tractatus is about form, okay? But form is not an object. It can't be, because it's the way that names or objects are joined together. It can't just be another object. It's got to be doing something else. So Wittgenstein concludes, hey, you can't talk about form. Pardon me? No, the Tractatus is full of discussion of form. He's in this situation. Heidegger, being, okay? What is it to be? And the answer is not, I'll have a pint of beer, please. Okay? What makes something be? Well, it's being which makes something be, but what the hell is being? Okay, so this is a question that Heidegger asked right at the beginning of Seinszeit, the Seinsfrage, the question of being. And immediately Heidegger asked the question. He says, well, there's one mistake you must not make. Being is not a being. It's what's behind beings. It's a bit sort of down, a bit Taoist. Now, the trouble is, being then is not a being. But if you want to answer the Seinsfrage, you've got to say, being is blah, 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 blah. Okay? To say being is so-and-so, you're treating it as an object. Okay? You're doing something that Heidegger thinks cannot be done. In fact, it's even worse than that. It's not just that you can't answer the Seinsfrage, you can't even ask the damn thing, right? What is being? It's like asking, you know, what is New York? You have to treat it as an object. So Heidegger is in the situation too. He recognises there's something you can't talk about, being, but then he goes ahead and talks about it. Now, all these philosophers were quite clear they were in this predicament. But this is not... The first two certainly thought they had ways out. Heidegger kept changing his mind. But certainly these two guys wanted to get rid of the contradiction. Heidegger tries to get rid of the contradiction, but in his very, very last writings, he seems to come to accept it. Okay. Anyway, this is not a lecture about the history of Western philosophy. I just wanted to show you this, so that you can see that the situation that 1B is in, or is endorsing, is not alien to the history of Western philosophy. It's going to hit any time that a philosopher gives reasons as to why you can't talk about something. All right. So, these are metaphysics, right? No. Strange things happen in metaphysics. Couldn't happen in a sensible subject like logic, could it? Okay. So this is where Ray's interests come back into the story. Ray, of course, was interested in the paradox of self-reference and makes great play of these things in a number of his writings. named Foreman Humphrey's text, and he loved, obviously loved puzzles and paradoxes. All right, the paradox of self-reference. Let's think about one. This guy is Julia Koenig. Okay, 1849 to 1913. And Koenig discovered a paradox, which bears his name today, Koenig's paradox. Koenig actually thought he'd refuted the continuum hypothesis, but the argument doesn't stack up. But what he had done was discover a paradox. Now, let me tell you what this paradox is. And it concerns the ordinals. Now, many of you will know what the ordinals are. For those of you who don't, let me just tell you very, very briefly. So here are the counting numbers, 0, 1, 2, and so on. According to the discovery, invention, call it what you will, of the great German mathematician Georg Cantor at the end of the 19th century, it makes perfectly good sense to imagine there's a number that's greater than all those, a least number greater than all those. It's infinite, okay, because it's bigger than all these finite guys, but it's the next one. And it's usually called omega. Then you get omega plus one, omega plus two, blah, 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 and then two lots of omega plus one, and then omega squared, and so on, so on, so on. Now, a couple of things about the ordinals. First of all, the ordinals share an important property with the counting numbers. Namely, if you have any collection, there must be a least. So if you've got a bunch of natural numbers, counting numbers, there's got to be a least. You can't have an infinitely ascending sequence of counting numbers, right? Mathematicians call this well ordering. And the ordinals share that property. Okay. Any set of ordinals has a least ordinal. That usually falls out of the way it's normally defined nowadays. All right, so that's something you need to know about the ordinals. Any set of them has a least member. And you know, you can prove that in set theory. Second thing you need to know, okay, and if you've never met the ordinals before, when you see this, the next thing you're going to ask is, how far does this go on? Right, tough question. This is tough both philosophically and mathematically. All right, it goes on forever and ever and ever to the absolute, whatever that is. Okay, we philosophers and mathematicians argue about what that is. However, one thing that no one argues about is the fact that it goes on a lot further than we've got names for. Because if you've got any language with a finite vocabulary, you can construct only a certain number of names in that language. And the number of names, well, if you've got a countable language, the number of names is going to be countable. You know what that means? You know what that means. If you don't know what that means, you don't know what it means, right? But there are a lot more of these guys than the countably many. So you can prove that, given a countable language, there have got to be ordinals that can't be named. And by the fact that if you've got any bunch of ordinals, there's a least. So consider the set of all ordinals that can't be named. There's a least. The least ordinal that can't be named. Oh, hang on. That's a name, right? So I seem to have named something that's ineffable. So this is Koenig's paradox, right? So what we've just seen is this. There are ordinals that can't be referred to in English, as it presently is, because you expand the language and so on. But if you take just English as it presently is, there are going to be ordinals that can't be referred to because the vocabulary of English is finer. So let alpha be the least. We know there is such a thing by the property of the ordinals. Since it cannot be referred to, one can say nothing about it. If I want to say something about an ordinal, I've got to be able to name it, refer to it, to say something. Okay? And since this guy has no name, it's the least thing that can't be named, I can't say anything about it. However, you can say something about it, namely you can say that it's the least indefinable ordinal. And you know, you can prove that there are such things. So you can explain why you can't refer to this thing. Now, okay, this is exactly a paradox at the limit of language, okay? The least indefinable ordinal is something that you can prove to exist. A fortiori, you can't talk about it. But hey, you can talk about it because, well, in giving the proof that there are unnameable ordinals, you have to talk about them. Or at least it gives you the ability to talk about it by using the description, the least ordinal so-and-so. Now, this is a very well-known paradox. It's not as sort of, not so much of a favorite as, you know, things like the lie, which are kind of hammered to death by logicians. But there are standard ways you might try to resolve this paradox. I actually personally don't think that any of them is very good. But, you know, the subject of today's talk is not about how you might go about solving these paradoxes. So let me just put my cards on the table. I think that just as 1B accepted the contradiction involved in talking about the ineffable, so the best thing to do with this situation is to accept the contradiction in talking about the least thing you can't talk about. Okay. So this is a kind of heresy that goes by the name of dialethism. Some contradictions are true. I asked Mel a couple of weeks ago what Ray's attitude was to dialethism. And he said, look, I don't think it was on Ray's agenda. Okay, so I don't actually think that Ray would seriously accept my view on this matter. But maybe it's too sensible for him. He really wanted something crazy. Thank you.
Very good. So, for the sake of time saving, I suggest we'll proceed with the remaining part, the third of the program, which is the open mic or whatever discussion. And there are some people who signed in for sharing their memories and speaking about Raymond. And about 10 people, so 5 minutes each. Good. And then we'll have 20 minutes to walk fast toward the restaurant. And we do all remember the name of the restaurant.
It's John Doe. It's on Fifth Avenue, on this side of the avenue between
28th
and
29th. Okay, you just don't cross the fields. Just go south, and within 5 blocks you're there. All right.
Great.
Okay. So then again, I'll abuse a little bit of my power here, and I'll rearrange speakers in certain order, and I will invite Rohit Parikh to start.
Thank you very much. Well, my first acquaintance with Raymond was actually 14 years before I met him. I was giving a job talk at Punjab University in India. This was in 1964. And I was the only logician in the room. I might have been the only logician in India at that time. The audience was largely people in number theory with a few analysts and algebraists thrown in, but they were very respectful of logic and they were interested. So I tried to explain to them Gödel's incompleteness theorem in a rather informal way, but I gave a kind of a sketchy proof. And during the course of the sketchy proof, I discovered a wonderful shortcut, which I explained to them. And they were all impressed that just in the course of a lecture, I discovered a new proof of the Gödel incompleteness theorem. So I wrote to my friend Georg Kreisel about this and said, isn't this wonderful? And then he wrote back and he said, Ruiz, you should take a look at Raymond Smullyan's copy of the theory of formal systems and see how much you have done which goes beyond what he has done. It turned out that I had done nothing beyond what Smullyan had done. What is more, I had actually a copy of the Theory of Formal Systems, which was a present from John Crosty, who was then in England but is now in Australia. And I don't know whether I read the book, remembered Smullyan's argument, and then forgot that Smullyan was the source of it, or whether I came up with it independently. I don't know. I certainly didn't have any intention of cheating, but I think Kreisel was polite in his letter to me, and being polite was not his habit. So I was pleased. In any case, by the time I got Kreisel's letter, Punjabi University had already offered me his position, which I accepted, and so I was a reader there, an associate professor, for a year and a half. Then, many years later, in the mid-70s, late-70s, I met Smullyan, where he gave a talk, either at Tufts or MIT, I'm not sure, and I took my 8-year-old son with me. Right? And I think that Smullyan was a little bit taken aback that somebody would bring a boy to one of his talks, but then Smullyan himself was a person who loved jokes and paradoxes, so maybe it was fine by him. But after that, we always stayed in touch, not meeting very often, but he sent me every single one of his books. Okay. So now, a much more recent memory, I gave a talk at a university called Vishwabharati. Now, Vishwabharati was founded by the poet Rabindranath Tagore, who was the first Asian to win the Nobel Prize in Literature. And it's a very interesting university because there were no classrooms, no walls. Classes took place under trees and so on and so forth. And it was a very original thing, so like kind of a mix between a forest resort and a kindergarten and a university, right? So Tagore also was, apart from being a Nobel Prize winner, he also wrote the national anthems for both India and Bangladesh. In any case, to come back to Smullyan, I saw a picture of Tagore. Tagore was long gone, but he's kind of a god there. I found a picture of Tagore in a local museum, and it looked so much like Smullyan that I said, I must bring this back. And so I gave it to Smullyan. This was maybe like 6-7 years ago. And Smullyan liked it. I've heard that it was on his wall in recent years. Okay, now I come to the last about Smullyan that I want to say, which is somewhat more serious, which is that Graham has already talked about Smullyan's interest in Taoism. But this interest apparently continued quite a bit, and there was a book that he wrote in 2003, and the title of the book is Who Knows? A Study of Religious Consciousness. And he starts by referring to a man called Overstreet, who was actually a professor at City College. But Overstreet is referring to a Canadian physician and psychiatrist whose name was Richard Buck. And Buck's idea is that every once in a while, somebody discovers cosmic consciousness. In fact, Buck's idea was that as evolution progresses, all of us will discover this cosmic consciousness. And so we become a part of the universe. The sense of sin goes away, because if we are a part of the universe, how can we be sinners unless we are outside it? And we are not outside it. And Smullyan was very struck by this book. I would say that his own book has this chapter, Cosmic Consciousness. And two of Smullyan's examples are not anybody from China, but two Westerners. One of them was Walt Whitman, and the other one was Havelock Ellis, who, of course, is known very much for a book about sex, but Smullyan points out that Havelock also had other interests. But so let me read two paragraphs from the book. And here's what Smullyan says. There is one passage of Whitman, which Buck did not mention, that I have found particularly intriguing and impressive. There is something comes home to one now and perpetually. It is not what is printed, preached, discussed. It eludes discussion and print. It is not to be put in a book. It's not in this book. It's for you, whoever you are. It's no farther from you than your hearing and sight are from you. It is hinted by nearest, commonest, readiest. It's not them, though it is endlessly provoked by them. what is there ready and near to you now? So it's the first paragraph from Whitman that Smullyan has. And here's the next one, again from Whitman. Here is the test of wisdom. Wisdom is not finally tested in schools. Wisdom cannot be passed from one having it to another not having it. Wisdom is of the soul, is not susceptible of proof, is its own proof. So it seems that Smullyan, I think maybe he moved away from paradoxes and found his way to what one might call real religion, and there the resemblance to Tagore, apart from the beard, becomes more astute, because Tagore himself was a deeply religious man, but he did not belong to any of the conventional Indian religions. He essentially spoke to God on his own, the way Martin Buber does. And this appreciation of beauty and going beyond is something that Tagore had and which Smullyan clearly had very explicitly. So I hope he found it before he went, or maybe he found it now.
What I'll suggest doing is proceeding alphabetically, but starting from Paris, not from A, because it's, otherwise we'll discriminate strongly against the people from. So Andrew Polonsky, ready?
Hi.
And introduce yourself.
Okay, thank you.
4 minutes, Andrew.
Yeah, sure. So yes, my name is Andrew Polonsky. I'm a postdoc in logic. I'm a logician of the younger generation. And I never met Raymond, and so unfortunately I cannot share any stories about him, but I can share a couple ways in which he touched my life. So in high school I was a pretty bad student and was very bored and not really inspired by anything, but I had a book of Raymond, A Riddle of Scheherazade, and other amazing puzzles, and that sort of kept my mind fresh, I think, for those years, and also perhaps prepared me for some of the mental skills that I would need later in my career. So perhaps that book that was just a birthday present brought me into mathematical logic eventually. So years later, I went to Europe. So this was in Connecticut. I went to high school in Connecticut, and I went to UConn and so on. And years later, I went to Europe and learned about this weird European kind of logic, like lambda calculus, type theory, proof theory, non-standard arithmetic, all those things. And my supervisor, Hein Barendrecht, I was supposed to do like a research problem during my studies. And my supervisor said, well, if you really want like a challenging problem, here is a problem by Raymond Smullyan that I was trying to crack for a few years. And I worked on it for some time, and finally it just sort of dawned on me, and I found a solution to this problem, which actually became my first scientific publication. So again, I think at that point, again, Raymond's input into my life was sort of consolidated in published form. And the problem was about self-reflection in combinatorial logic. So combinatorial logic is like a first order cousin of the lambda calculus. It's actually arguably the first model of computation, the first actual Turing complete concept of computability. It was just invented a decade before Church's thesis was actually enunciated. But the problem of self-reflection, of course, self-reflection is somehow pervasive through mathematical logic and Raymond's also writings and a lot of people's interests also related to what you were talking about the sort of cosmic consciousness and Gödel's ideas about this and so on. And this was just like, I think this is still an open problem to understand self-reflection in mathematical logic and all the different ways that it seems to arise over and over and over again into all these very different branches of it. But this was just a very specific piece of the puzzle, which was to axiomatize the quote operator, the universal enumerator. It's like the universal Turing machine that is in the Turing model. There is also like a kind of universal Turing machine in the lambda calculus, and the idea was to axiomatize its properties abstractly. And so that was fun, but there is a lot more work to do. So thanks for Raymond for inspirations, and let his spirit live on. Thank you.
Wayne Richter.
So I'm still Wayne Richter. My wife and I went to visit Raymond a little over a year ago in Elko Park. I had not seen him for a number of decades, and my wife had never seen him. There was a sign on the door saying, "Wayne, just come in." It turns out there were two Waynes coming. And in fact, both of the two Waynes are actually here tonight. Anyway, we walked in, there was Raymond sitting watching public television. And he saw us, he stood up, held out his hands, and you can guess what he said. Pick a card. And that went on for a while. And later, I had brought two of his books that I wanted him to sign. I was going to give them to my grandchildren. He signed the first book, and then he said, "I'm not going to sign the second." And he took the book, and he wrote in it, "I wish you the best, but I refuse to sign this book." Just to let the person know whose signature was not going to be given, Raymond wrote his name. Okay. Now let's go back a few decades. I met Raymond in graduate school. We were both graduate students together. Raymond had quite a life before he went to graduate school. But I got to know him quite well because Alonzo Church was not there. And this is not any disrespect to Church, but Church went on sabbatical to UCLA and wanted to rent his house. So Raymond and another mathematical physicist, Nick Burgoyne, don't know what happened to him, were going to rent the house. They wanted a third person, so they asked me if I would also take part of the rent. So I did. They put me in the basement as the youngest, but the basement was quite nice. It actually was Church's study in the basement. So I spent a year in Church, living in Church's study. It was very nice. Raymond was upstairs, Nick Burgoyne was upstairs. Blanche was in New York, but she would come down frequently on the weekends. Couple things. Church apparently loved science fiction. The bookcase at the top row was a row of science fiction periodicals. Raymond came down one day, picked one off the shelf. I'm sure he'd seen it before. But in the table of contents, one of the numbers was wrong for the pages. Now, if you know Church, he was quite meticulous. He had corrected page number in the book correct page. This is an editor at its best. I'm just going to give you two more anecdotes. One is about Blanche. We were at one of the logic conferences at Cornell, I guess in the summer, and after dinner everyone was sitting around talking, and there was a mathematician playing the piano. I won't mention his name, but I thought he was pretty good. Unfortunately, he was playing classical music, where everyone was talking. And Blanche is a real classical musician and thought it was quite inappropriate to be talking while classical music was being played. So, you know, I never forgot this. He leaned over to me and whispered, "Why is he doing this?" And I tried to explain that, you know, this is background music. And after a while, she leaned over again and said, "He tries very hard." And I realized then that trying very hard is not always a compliment. So, one more anecdote, this is the last one. Raymond made wonderful scrambled eggs. I don't know if anyone has had Raymond's scrambled eggs. He burned the butter, put large amounts of butter in the pan, burns the butter, and then adds the eggs. And they were delicious.
See you, Toledo?
Toledo? Yes.
Now, I'm one of Raymond's PhD students and have been a friend of his since then. I wrote 10 pages. I went over through all my interactions with Raymond over the years, so I won't do that. I'm going to the first paragraph. And the first paragraph is about my summary of what Raymond meant to me. And I'm putting myself back into the first day I was a student, or the first month I was a student in his classes, and what it meant to have him as my teacher. So I had studied with Church, you know, with John Addison, reading Church's book. And I don't know why I stayed in logic, because I was bored. And I didn't feel it totally understood. But something, I knew I liked philosophy, logic, epistemology. I went to yeshiva, and I'm in Raymond's class the first week I'm at yeshiva. Everything was clear, everything was beautiful. And it's the clarity of his exposition that first just blew me away and got me to stay in logic for a long time. The second thing about it, I have 1, 2, 3 here. I had two friends that are in the same category, Stanley Tannenbaum and Raymond. They were both close friends. These two people have this joy in intellectual life. And with Raymond, also the aesthetic life, I think with Stanley too, but this just deep pleasure in life. And it was very inspiring to me because that's what I believed that, I mean, it had been, my intellectual life was my solace in many times. So that inspired me and made me very happy for a long time. But the third thing I was thinking about as I wrote this was, as a student, what impressed me? What impresses me now as I think about being a student? This pleasure I took in all his classes. One is that every student knew that he really cared about you as a person. Secondly, he would welcome any question, he would be delighted in any question you asked. And thirdly, you knew he wanted you to take pleasure. We loved him. Thank you.
Paula Tushin.
No, I didn't sign it.
Oh, it's just a mistake, okay, sorry. Really? Yes. Do you want to?
No, I didn't.
Oh, because, well, it's... Somebody said yes and did it. Okay. Dana Richards. Yes.
So, just writing notes to myself. My glasses don't work. So. First off, I'm Dana Scott Richards. I actually ran into Dana Scott at a conference. We had a nice talk, got our pictures taken together. Of course, Dana Scott and Smullyan are both students of Church. I'm a professor of computer science at George Mason University, so I understand this from a different viewpoint. I met Raymond, well, I've seen him actually give lectures before, but I really met him at the Gathering for Gardeners, which is something I have a great abiding interest in, Marcus Gardner. And he did too, of course, and he would come to all of the Gathering for Gardner conferences, and in fact, more than Gardner himself ever came to. And of course, he also, like a lot of people, you know, from Escher on up, you know, became famous because of Gardner and his knight and knave puzzles, as well as his retrograde chess puzzles, all became popular because of Gardner's column. But he also had philosophical differences with Gardner. One of his books, a third of the book, is just him criticizing Gardner's philosophy. He just felt it was important that Gardner understood that he disagreed with him. And wrote an entire third of a book on it. I think it might have been Who Cares? I'm not sure. Who knows? I don't know. I don't remember which book it is anymore. Gardner knew him in Chicago in the 40s. They were both University of Chicago. Gardner was a student of Carnap. But where they knew each other is they were both magicians in Chicago. And if you've ever seen the pictures of him dressed up as a magician, he actually performed. Gardner never performed, but that's where they became friends in the 40s. And stayed friends because, since they were friends and he wanted people to know about his stuff, he sent it to Gardner once he became wrote a column for Scientific American. Now, my glasses are bad. I once went up to him and I said, the sentence must have been something like, since you're a Buddhist, and he stopped me. He was livid. I mean, he was not just correctly, he was close to being angry. I never said I was a Buddhist, you know, and it's sort of one of those things, you know, because he said so much about Buddhism. He's obviously affected by the Taoism, but I was startled by how he reacted to that remark. Another thing, if you ever met him and you were an attractive woman, he always had a series of questions he would ask attractive women. And regardless of whether you said yes or no, you ended up agreeing to let him kiss you. And what the answer was, there was no alternative than you would agree to let him kiss you. So he would do this to everybody, my wife and everybody else he met. He's quite good at that. And finally, my list of things here. I only did one thing that impressed him. And so, of course, I have great pride in this. But we were at the Gathering for Gardner, and I told him something, and he jumped up and he ran, Gathering for Gardner! Look at that. Hey! Gathering for Gardner bag here. All right. He jumped up and ran back and wrote it down, so he must not have heard it before. And I said to him, you know, every syllogism has three parts. Therefore, this is not a syllogism.
Yeah. So please bear with me. So this list is not quite reliable, so I try to do my best. So Silver Ballet?
Yes. Okay. Yeah, I'm just going to share the poem that I wrote for Raymond for his 95th birthday. I got to know Raymond in Alpha Park because of my friends Sylvie and Wayne. So I got to know him the last several years of his life. And it was delightful because participating on these great events at the Platte Clove Gallery. He liked to sing. He would play Beethoven, but he had this wonderful song that he wrote. I think his brother might have written or they co-wrote. Charlie was a poor old horse who never got enough oats. Inspired by when they learned that their living room furniture was stuffed with horse hair. But anyway, I got invited to Raymond Smullyan's 95th birthday party, and I wrote him this poem, which he loved. And he actually closed his. I ended up in the Lovely Ladies I Have Known chapter of Reflections, and it's the last page of that book. He made one edit. He explained to me, I used the phrase, infinite like the popular pie is in the poem, and he just explained to me that popular pie is not infinite. So I'm just going to say the poem now, so I don't want to give the whole thing away. I think I can remember it because it's kind of short. And it goes like this. Smullyan, Smullyan, riddle me this. What is the Mobius without the twist? Without nothing, can something exist? Can a year be measured by a trip around the sun? Could it be we were zero before we were one? Do numbers ever lie? Has it ever been thus? And do numbers ever lie? Could our souls be infinite like the decimal expansion of pi? And if I were to count your years, each one equaling five, I'd say congratulations for these 19 years alive. Happy birthday.
We're doing pretty well, actually, yes. Robert Cohen.
I pronounce it Cowan.
Cowan, yes, the session.
So, I was a professor at Queens College for many, many years, and I've known Raymond since 1958. And, I have many, many memories of Raymond, and it's hard to linearize my thoughts when I think about Raymond. I always think of something, oh, that reminds me of. But anyway, so I made some notes to help me linearize my thoughts. So I first met Raymond, I think it was in 1958. I was a student at Princeton and an undergraduate there, and I had the pleasure of taking his logic course. And it was quite an amazing experience, probably accounts for why I was a logician all these years. He's a marvelous teacher, as everybody has known him, has said, and it was marvelous because you saw mathematics being discovered as he taught. It wasn't a dull, recapitulation of what went before, but he would come in with new things all the time. And this was really, really very exciting. And I got hooked on that habit and started, trying to discover mathematics myself. So another thing, it was mentioned that he got his PhD at Princeton, and it was also mentioned the church was on sabbatical that year. His thesis advisor actually was another one of my teachers at Princeton, Hilary Putnam. Now, Hilary was younger than Smullyan, but he served as his thesis advisor anyway, and I think they published a joint paper together. Mel has mentioned the paper of Putnam Smullyan, so I think that may have come out of their close collaboration. Let's see. Now, I was a graduate student at Yeshiva, as Mel was, and I took his class in set theory, and that was also very inspiring and very interesting. Since I had taken logic so many times before, I didn't take his logic class, and I didn't take Martin Davis's logic class, which probably was a big mistake. I had taken logic, I think, first from Hempel at Princeton, and then Smullyan, and then Putnam. So I thought I knew it all, and then I should have taken Martin Davis's course. I would have learned a lot from it. So I had a very close relationship with Ray, and he gave me his manuscript for what is the name of this book. I looked at it a bit, and then I gave it to my daughter, Lenore, who was 10 years old, and she loved it. She, went through all of it and even made some corrections, found a few errors, and that really hooked her on mathematics, I think. She's become a mathematician, and so he's really influenced my family. I think he mentions her in the preface of this, what is the name of this book, and interesting thing, she told me afterwards that you know, she really thought more of me since I had Raymond Smullyan as a friend. I don't know what to make of that. So Smullyan was a polymath, as mentioned. His interests were music, math, astronomy, which I shared. I had built a telescope and ground the mirror, and he was very interested in that, and I explained how this was done, and I think he went on to grind the mirror himself. Also astronomy, magic, philosophy, stereophotography, motion pictures made from still photographs, jokes. He loved jokes of all kinds, and was had an encyclopedic memory of jokes, which he shared with everybody. He had a very sharp mind, and even we visited him, I think, maybe a year before he died. He was still very sharp. It was quite amazing, you know, the quality of his mind right up to the end. Very inspiring. And one last story, which I think he's told lots of people, why he became a logician. He said his older brother, I guess it must have been Arthur, on April Fool's Day said, "Raymond, today I'm really going to fool you." And Raymond said, "Yeah." So he was very excited all day long and waited and waited and waited, and then nothing happened. Nothing strange happened. So at the end, Arthur said to him, "Raymond, you thought I was going to fool you, didn't you?" And Raymond said, "Yes, yes, I did. And I didn't do it." He said, "Yes, yes, you didn't do it. So I fooled you, didn't I?" So he said he thought about that for a long time. And credits that was a different interest in logic.
Again, on the risky ground, so just trying to pronounce the name. See the yes. Because it, yeah.
A little before, not used to speaking to many people, but when I used to go with Raymond to poetry reading, he told me, "Are you going to read something?" And I'd say, "I don't know, I'm not sure. No, I don't think so." Say, "If you go, I go." So I'm going. And in the word of Raymond, "Before I speak to you, let me tell you a few words." First of all, I want to say it's very unfair that all the obituaries concerning Raymond say that he was 97 years old. Because he was born in 1919, May 25th, 1919, and he died in February 6th, 2017. And death makes that he covered 98 years. And so that was just a few months short of, so we can say that he was 90 years old. On top of that, the number 98, it turns into 9 plus 8, which equals 17, and 1 plus 7 is 8. In numerology, this is the number for infinity, which we believe he belongs to. I think that the secret of a long life may be to be able to let go of rigid system. Love dwarfs logic in generating energy. Yet logic produces momentum. Raymond believed in logic. He believed in love. He believed in both. He also believed in simplicity, in fantasy, in music. He was a great believer. He believed in people. This is why we are here together, to celebrate what he gave us by being born. And if reborn by fate or chance, maybe the traveling minstrel he always was and also wanted to be. Yes, if the option presents itself, he sought to come back as a touring singer-entertainer. So at the end of the day, isn't our voice the most important attribute? And this is why, in honor of Raymond Merrill Smullyan, I would like to propose to you to sing together. And I know that it's maybe a lot to ask for certain, but let's just make a tone. We all have our own tone, so we do not have to sing the tone of other people. And for those who doesn't know how to make a tone, just imitate a car on a highway at a constant speed. That was it. At the count of three. One, two, three.
Billy Joy Lucas. No?
I have a check.
Anyone else wants to speak?
Because we stand of the least of all the false positives.
But I don't want to.
Are there any false negatives?
Mel, do you want to say a couple of words?
What about you, sir?
Just a quote. Well, I end up arranging things for Raymond all the time, so I'm so glad to have had his 90th birthday conference. And, did you make a volume for Raymond? Yes?
It hasn't appeared yet, but there will be one.
There will be one, yes. And, yes.
Can I say one more thing?
Yes, please.
I just will say it from here. Because I regret one thing about the last, removing off of the last first paragraph. Because I wanted to mention Sylvie Dejé and her husband Wayne Lopez, who were Raymond's real support system for the last decade of his life, and did beautiful things, arranged concerts. They made concerts together, they made music. I don't know if that happened. I never was able to go to one of them, but I know how much Sylvie helped him in the last few months of the last year. I mean, because she helped me help him, and it was, this woman is amazing and her husband is amazing. So I just wanted to introduce her.
Yes, I'm trying to remember that he had a favorite joke about like a nurse assistant goes to the doctor and says, there's somebody here who wants to see you, who thinks that they're invisible. And he said, tell him I can't see him now. That was one of his favorites.
All right.
Well, I'd like to welcome you just to come and sign.
Yes, don't forget to sign the guest book. Yes. And so I gather into the restaurant. Would you care to lay down this address? And by 7 o'clock, please don't be late because I'm getting nervous. Yes.
We sent the pictures and not doing anything.